Okay, good morning everybody from Cologne to all over the world. Thank you very much for the invitation to this interesting event of the Statistical Methods Group. I try to explain why we in IQWiG think about to apply Bayesian methods more than in the past, especially for the situation of meta-analysis with very few studies. Just in short, most of you will know that we have two main models in meta-analysis. There are more, but these are the most important ones. We have the fixed effect model, which is better called a common effect model, because the assumption is that we estimate a common effect in all individual studies. This is a very strict assumption and frequently not adequate. So, more important is the random effects model, where we allow some heterogeneity, but of course it should be not too large. It should be meaningful to pool all these individual studies. For a couple of years, the Knapp-Hartung method, also called Hartung-Knapp-Sydig-Jonkmann, is recommended in practice. But we are faced with a problem that, in the case of very few studies, and I mean the situation of two, three, or four studies, the heterogeneity parameter tau cannot be estimated reliably. So the Knapp-Hartung method is over-conservative in the case of very few studies. And what we currently do is that we either apply the fixed effect model, even in situation where it may be questionable whether the assumption is true, or we use a qualitative evidence synthesis and we try different things. And this is a circumstantial procedure, and we want to have something better. So here's one example from an IQWiG report. We have two significant studies, and in IQWiG language, this if we have two significant studies on the right side, then this is a proof of added benefit. So if we apply the former standard, the Desmond and Laird method, we get this result. Okay. Here's a result of the fixed effect model. We could also use this, but here we have an I-square of over 50%. And if the design of these two studies is not the same, the assumption of fixed effect model is questionable. And yeah, if we want to apply a random effects model, we know from simulation studies that Desmond and Laird, the confidence interval is too small. And yeah, if you apply the recommended Knapp-Hartung, we get this result. And yeah, we see that Knapp-Hartung is over-conservative. A decision of no significant overall effect in this situation with two significant studies is critical. Think about the situation. If you have only the first study, then you will say, oh, we have a significant effect. In IQWiG language, this is only an indication because we have only one significant study. If this is replicated by a second study, then to use Knapp-Hartung and say there is no effect, this is very critical. So there are other methods. We can use Bayesian methods, but now we have the situation that is indeed a compromise between Desmond and Laird, where the confidence interval is too small, and Knapp-Hartung, which is too wide. We see here that the Bayesian confidence or credibility intervals lie between these extreme cases. But the problem is the final result depends on the prior distribution. If we use the half normal with prior distribution of scale parameter half, then we get a significant result. If we use a different one with scale parameter one, we get a not significant result. And these discussions, which prior you have to use if you want to apply a Bayesian method, should be made in advance and not when you have the results. So in short, Bayesian method means that you combine the prior with the likelihood. In a random effects meta-analysis, this means you need prior distributions for the parameter of the main interest and the heterogeneity parameter. In IQWiG, we think that for the overall mean effect, we should always use a non-informative prior. But for the heterogeneity parameter, it may be useful to use weakly informative priors to overcome the limitations that you cannot estimate tau reliably in the case of very few studies. There is some knowledge in the literature about possible prior distributions. Here's an overview. This is a paper in press in the journal Research Synthesis Methods. For pragmatic reasons, we concentrate on these half-normal distributions which are recommended in this paper. We can compare it with a log-normal distribution proposed by Turner. Julian's cited this paper in the introduction. And we have some knowledge what is a small, reasonable, fairly high, and fairly extreme heterogeneity. But we want to know which distribution is suitable in our health technology assessment framework. So the basic question is how many probability mass you should place in this fairly extreme range. Could we ignore this and use a distribution with all the most probability mass here, or should we allow that we have also heterogeneity in these ranges? To get knowledge about this, we collected all meta-analysis of IQWiG reports up to June 2020, applied the Knapp-Hartung method combined with the Paolo-Mandel method for the estimation of tau. Under these conditions, we made histograms to illustrate the empirical distribution of tau and compare it with the half-normal distributions with scale parameter a half and one. The interim results are as follows. We have up to now meta-analysis from 653 IQWiG reports, all in all over 1,600 meta-analysis. We considered these four effect measures. One problem is that we see that the case of very few studies is very frequent in IQWiG. Over 75% of all the meta-analysis have study number below five. Then we made some restrictions. We only used estimates of tau larger than zero. Maybe this could be a discussion point whether there are better options in practice. And we used only meta-analysis without substantial heterogeneity because in these cases in practice, we would not pool the results. And so it makes sense to restrict the histograms of tau only to situations where we would pool in practice. So here's this problem that in about 60% of all situations, we get this zero estimate for tau. And with these two restrictions, we have these number of meta-analysis. Hazard ratio is not shown later because the number of meta-analysis is just too low. Yeah, here's the result for the odds ratio. And at first sight, we think the half-normal distribution with scale parameter half seems to be suitable for the odds ratio because we have a very low situation in this range of fairly extreme. So the green line may be a suitable option for the odds ratio. The same holds for the risk ratio. For the SMD, we can think about to use a distribution with even a smaller scale parameter. because we have no situation where we find a tau in this range. So the interim conclusion is that the first results are promising. The half normal distribution with scale parameter half seems to be suitable for the odds ratio and the risk ratio. For the SMD, the distribution with a smaller scale parameter seems to be possible, but the pragmatic approach, of course, would be to use the same prior distribution for all effect measures. And this would be maybe the half normal with scale parameter half. Before we make a final decision, we want to check what the impact is of using different prior distributions. We will also consider the log normal and probably the Cauchy distribution. And we want to investigate in the near future that whether it is possible that we can really avoid the qualitative evidence synthesis by use of Bayesian meta-analysis. We could say yes to this question if in this situation shown in the beginning, that means if we have two or three significant studies and Knapphartung would yield a non-significant pooled effect estimate, when we apply the Bayesian approach with the weakly informative prior, will this yield a significant overall effect? Then this would be useful. And if this is possible, we will discuss our decision for a suitable standard prior distribution together with experts from biometric societies in Germany. And if we will be successful, we will apply Bayesian meta-analysis with this chosen standard prior for tau in the case of very few studies in the future. Thank you very much for your attention. I think we are a few minutes behind our schedule, but I hope it's not a large problem.
Thank you, Dr. Bender, for an informative presentation. There are several questions and comments online, and we will attempt to address them at the end of the presentations. But so far, one clarifying question says, Ikvik language means counting significant results, which is a sort of vote counting, apparently encouraged by regulatory instances. So you may want to comment on that.
We do not use this vote counting as a standard approach, but I said two significant studies is a proof of added benefit. Because for example, in the situation where we have where you have two studies with a very large heterogeneity, an I square of 100% or something like that, and you decide that it makes no sense to pool these results. In this case, we do not apply a quantitative meta-analysis, but we have to give a recommendation for the Joint Federal Committee whether there is an added benefit of this medical intervention. And yes, if we have two significant studies and each study shows an added benefit, we would say two significant studies is sufficient for a proof of added benefit. But how large the benefit is, this is non-quantifiable. This is some kind of vote counting, but we do not count one, two, three. We just say if one study is just an indication, and if we have two significant studies, this is a proof, which is a little bit better. You can read more details in our methods paper on the ICWIC webpage. And this paper, version 6 of last year, is also available in English.